من كثيرا ما دام يجري هذا النظام وبعد قال تبارك وتعالى هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر نورا وقدره منازل لتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب ما خلق الله ذلك إلا بالحق يفصل الآيات لقوم يعلمون وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تصوموا حتى تروا الهلال ولا تفطروا حتى تروه فإن غم عليكم فاقدروا له أو كما قال عليه الصلوات والتسليمات. Respected brothers, elders, mothers, sisters and youngsters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. We begin as always by praising the Almighty, our Creator, our Sustainer, the only one entitled to worship, and we convey the best of salutations upon the final messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings upon him. The month of Ramadan is dawning upon us, and as it creeps slowly or quickly upon us, we supplicate and we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to welcome the blessed month of Ramadan and take full advantage of the blessings and the mercy that descends in the blessed month, Shahru Ramadan. And as Shaykh Ashraf Ali Thanwi, rahimahullah, had made a mention, istaqbiluhu bishawqi wal hayman, that as the month of Ramadan enters, gets closer, arrives, then welcome it, embrace it with anticipation, with fervor, with the passion to take full advantage of it. So they generally say, it's mind over matter. So if we look at the month of Ramadan as a blessing, as something that is positive, as something to embrace and engage in valuing, then it'll become positive for us. However, if we look at it, oh, I have to stay hungry for so many hours. I have to stand in prayer for lengthy, raka'ahs in taraweeh, and so on and so forth, then it's going to seem challenging, it's going to seem difficult. So once again, we supplicate and we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to embrace the month of Ramadan as it comes nearby and allow us to value it and look forward to it. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. I recited a verse before you, and in this verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yunus makes a mention of the creation of the sun and the moon. And particularly Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء. Allah is the being that created the sun as a lamp, as a force of light. والقمر نورا, as well as the moon, as something that derives light from the sun, and then it's like a lantern, it shines it to others. وَقَدَّرَهُ مَنَازِلَ لِتَعْلَمُوا عَدَدَ السِّنِينَ وَالْحِسَابِ. And the Almighty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says that Allah has determined for the moon different stages, different phases. Manazil is the plural of manzil, different stages or positions of the moon. And those who study the moon, they'll tell us that there's a waning moon or a waning crescent, and there's a waxing crescent, there's the first quarter, there's the third quarter, there's the full moon, so on and so forth. These are the different stages of the moon that the Almighty is speaking about. Then Allah mentions why He has created the system of the moon and the sun. لِتَعْلَمُوا عَدَدَ السِّنِينَ وَالْحِسَابِ. So that you can understand the count of the years. Wal-hisab, and you can calculate your time. So whenever someone asks us, what day is it? We're either going to say the specific day and the month, and that month is either connected to the solar movements, if we're talking about January, February, so on and so forth, or we're going to say it's Sha'ban, we're going to say it's Rajab, we're going to say it's Ramadan. So we're connecting the date with the movements of the moon. So Allah is saying here in this verse specifically that the stages of the moon are to help you determine the time, to compute time, to figure out what your date is. لِتَعْلَمُوا عَدَدَ السِّنِينَ وَالْحِسَابِ. You can figure out what year and what date it is. So when we look at the moon generally in today's context, there's so much magnificence about the moon. We can look at it as a great creation, and we can be reminded about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how great He is. إِنَّ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَاخْتِلَافِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ لَآيَاتٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, in this creation of the heavens and the earth, you will find signs. And those signs, they will help you acknowledge the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That if Allah is so, if the creation is so perfect, it's so, awesome, it's so magnificent, then how great and awesome is the Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of the scholars, they talk about the angels. An angel, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, is mentioned in some of the narrations that if he is to open one wing on the east, it'll cover the entire east. And if he is to open another wing, it'll cover the entire west. And if all the water bodies on this earth, all the oceans, all the water, all the sea of this earth is to be placed on the head of the angel, not even a droplet will fall off. So if this is how great the angel is, how magnificent and how great is the creator of this angel and so many other angels. And that's why we say Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the greatest. And that's the being that we submit to. So as Ramadan comes, many a times the topic of moon sighting happens. And sometimes the moon sighting gets into moon fighting. So nevertheless, what we are addressing today is the context. You know, when I graduated in 1998 as a young scholar of Islam, and I came back to Toronto, since I've been in Toronto, I've been part of different moon sighting committees. I recall as a young scholar, 1999, Sheikh Maulana Khalil, rahimahullahu ta'ala, he was the founder of the Toronto Hilal Committee. He personally asked me to be a director and a board member of the Toronto Hilal Committee. And for so many years, I served alongside him, and I saw the growth. And the entire process is based on the narration of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, where he said, "Sumu li ru'yatihi wa aftiru li ru'yatihi." That when you see the moon, then commence your month. And when you see the moon, then conclude the month. I quoted a narration before you. There's so many versions of it. The particular narration that I referenced is from Muwatta Imam Malik, rahimahullah. And in there, he quotes a chain to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, wherein the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "La tasumu hatta tarawul hilal," that do not fast until you observe and see the new crescent. "Wala tuftiru hatta tarawhu," and don't conclude your fasting month until you observe and see the moon. "Fa'in ghumma alaykum faqduru lah," if the moon perchance is obscured, ghumma, it's hidden, there's clouds, it's inaccessible. You know, many a times the climate we have here in North America, there's clouds, it's difficult to spot the moon. "Fa'in ghumma alaykum," if it is concealed, if it is obscured, if it's hidden from you, "faqduru lah," then calculate the moon. Calculate the position of the moon, and then determine when you're going to start fasting or when you're going to start or conclude the fasting. So what we understand from this entire process, I was referring to the Toronto Hilal Committee, the history of the Toronto Hilal Committee. It goes back to the time in the early 1970s where the region for spotting the moon was only the Toronto city. And if a sighting was in Cambridge, it wouldn't be accepted by the Muslims of Toronto, according to the Toronto Hilal Committee. Then it expanded. Shah Uncle is right here. He was always with us in these meetings. Then they expanded to Buffalo, and they expanded to Chicago, then the rest of North America. and now also the Caribbean. And then we have many different organizations that sprouted out of the Toronto Hilal Committee, for example, the Hilal Council, who bases their decision on global sighting, wherever it's seen in the entire world. So this has been the growth and the advancement based on the communities growing in North America, particularly here in Toronto, one of the most densely Muslim populated cities across North America. At least 10% of the population here in Toronto are Muslim. So with the growth of the community, you see different changes in the community as well. And in every era, in every time, those specific changes that were made, they were made appropriate to the need of the time. And this is what is unique about fiqh. This is what is unique about jurisprudence. That jurisprudence is flexible based on the circumstance. A man came to the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings upon him, and he said to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, "Can I kiss my wife when I'm fasting?" And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "No." In the same gathering, another man came and he asked the same question, "Can I kiss my wife when I'm fasting?" And the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, "Yes." So the same question was posed, but the answers varied. If you look at the reasonings behind this, the fuqaha, the jurists tell us, the first person who asked, he was a young man, he had just gotten married. So his kiss would not end at a kiss. It would go all the way to the end, which would constitute the breaking of the fast. So the Prophet ﷺ looked at his circumstance and said, "No, you can't kiss your wife." The other man was an elderly man. He had already been married for several years. His kiss would end at a kiss. It wouldn't lead to something further. So that's why the jurors say that if a person has the discipline, then the hug, the kiss is fine while you're fasting. But if it leads to intercourse or sexual intimacy, it's going to break the fast. You rather abstain and stay away from it. So circumstance can vary the ruling. One person has a disability. So that person is asking the fatwa that, "Can I sit and pray?" We're going to say, for sure, you can't stand, so how can you pray standing? You don't have the ability. But a person who's healthy, a person who has the ability to stand, we're going to say, the Quran says, "Qumu lillah," that when you stand for prayer, you're standing. It's fard to stand. It's mandatory to stand. So circumstance can change the ruling. And this is what we see when it comes to the moonsighting committees and all of the discussions. And the interesting point is, many of us, when we look at the topic or the issue of moonsighting, we assume it to be something of halal and haram. We assume it to be something of permissible and impermissible, allowed and not allowed. Whereas that is not the reality. The reality is, all of the various opinions, whether it's local sighting in your own city, or whether it's global sighting internationally, or to a certain extent, or to follow the declaration of Saudi Arabia, or to adopt calculations, every one of these methods, they are all permissible, but the question is, which one is preferred? Which one is preferred for each community? So we, as a Muslim community in North America, we are considered an aqalliya. We are a minority in North America. We don't have a central authority that's making a decision in regards to the communal matters. I was just in Umrah, alhamdulillah. There's a central authority. There's a central authority. So if I'm in Saudi Arabia, and there's a declaration made by the government that today is Eid, whether it meets your calculation or not, whether you see it or not, you're gonna start your celebration. The declaration was made by a central authority in a Muslim country. The problem is, we don't live in a Muslim country. So who's our central authority? There's no central authority. And that's why we have these established organizations, Hilal Committee, Moonsighting Committee, the Fiqh Council of North America. And what they do is they take one of these opinions from the various opinions, they adopt one and they say, this seems to be the preferred opinion for our context, and we suggest that you follow this particular view to begin your month and to conclude your month. So without a central authority, we have to make the decision in the community ourselves. Now, another issue in reference to the moon sighting is that there's a question that is posed by the jurist. Is sighting of the moon a maqsood? Is it an aim? Is it an objective in itself? Is it the end goal? Or is it only a means to the end goal? Is it a wasila? Is it a means to the end goal? So, to make this simple, we all came to Jummah. Some of us came in our cars, some of us came walking, some of us came on a bus, some of us took Ubers. Whatever it is, we came to Jummah. So our walking, our driving, our getting onto a bus or a train or an Uber is not the maqsood, it's not the aim. A person doesn't just get into a vehicle and they have no aim. The aim is, I want to get to a destination. Your aim was, you want to get to Jummah prayer. So that's the aim, that's the objective. You want to get to Jummah prayer and perform the Jummah prayer. The means to get to the Jummah prayer, it can vary. It's not the end goal. The end goal is to perform your Jummah prayer. So the scholars, they get into a huge debate and a discussion. The jurists, the fuqaha, the ulama, they get into a big discussion. Is sighting of the moon, the physical naked eye sighting of the moon, is it an objective and an aim in itself? Or is it actually a means to the goal? Some jurists say it's an objective to actually go out and see the moon. Others say it's not an objective. The objective is actually to start the month. And then they give some examples. So a person who's in prison, he's not allowed to go outside to see the sun or the moon. He's confined to his space. If this person gets knowledge that Ramadan has started, he has to start his fasting. He didn't physically see the moon, yet it will be mandatory on him to fast. So giving this example, the jurists say that looking at the moon is not necessarily an objective. It's only a means. And we do prayer here. How many of us, the Prophet ﷺ, the actual sunnah is the Prophet ﷺ would look at the sun. He would look at the sun and he would say, okay, now the sun has reached zawal. And then he said, okay, now dhuhr or Jummah prayer starts. He would look at the sun for every prayer. How many of us actually do this? We don't. We look at the scientific data and the calculation that tells us that's been calculated. If you ask me, if I ask you, what time is Jummah Salah next February or in June? You'll take out your apps, you'll take out your calendar, and you'll tell me, on this date next year, this is what time the Dhuhr prayer will start. So it's calculated scientifically, because the means is just to determine when that timing starts, whether it's calculated scientifically or whether it's done physically by sighting. So similarly, this whole discussion of, is the sighting of the moon actually an aim and objective? Some scholars say it is an objective, it's an act of worship and it should be done. And others say it's not an objective, it's actually just a wasila, it's a means to the end goal to determine the beginning of the month or the conclusion of the month. So, keeping this in mind, I quote the great Sheikh, the Allama, the great scholar, Allama Aini. He's done a commentary, Badruddin Al-Aini. He's done a commentary on Sahih Al-Bukhari. And anyone who studies Sahih Al-Bukhari, they'll know of this great scholar who's done a detailed discussion of every hadith that is in Sahih Al-Bukhari. So when he talks about the hadith which I quoted, فَقْدُرُوا لَهُ, that if the moon is obscured, then calculate it. He says that there's several meanings here. And one of the meanings, he says, is that The Prophet ﷺ is telling us, if you can calculate the moon and begin your month or conclude your month, then that is permissible, especially if there is climate that makes it difficult for you to sight it. So the Prophet ﷺ is giving us permission here, according to the Shaykh Al-Aini, rahimahullah, that you can calculate the sighting of the moon, especially in a situation when you're in climates that it's difficult to see. And then he quotes, كِبَارٌ مِّنَ التَّابِعِينَ. He says, there are many from amongst the senior tabi'un, that is the students of the Sahaba, the students of the companions, radiyallahu ta'ala anhum, who would calculate the positions of the moon and begin the month and conclude the month. And then he concludes the discussion by talking about what I just referenced. He says the objective is not necessarily to see the moon physically with our naked eye. It's actually by determining whether the moon is there or not. And being part of many Hilal committees and moonsighting organizations, I've seen many a times, how do the meetings take place? We gather at a masjid and we're picking up the phone and we're asking different parts of the world and we're getting emails. Have you sighted the moon in Guyana? Have you sighted the moon in South Africa? Okay, we have to know who you are. Okay, who sighted it? Let's have a little interview. Very rarely did any of these committees actually go out to physically sight the moon here. Two reasons for this. One is the climate doesn't allow it. It's impossible to be seen. And that's why many a times we hear those organizations that are making the announcements for moon sighting, they say, we based their decision on a sighting in the Caribbean, or in LA, Los Angeles, or in Chicago. So it's very rare that the moon is sighted here. So the decision even here is based on information that is coming from another locality. No doubt the actual sunnah, no one can argue that. No doubt the actual sunnah is to physically sight the moon with the eye. But that's not the end result. The end objective is, did the month start or not? So, mashallah, the board here at the Islamic Foundation of Toronto has been discussing with several scholars. They also sat down with me and they made a decision alongside myself that inshallah we are going to be adopting the calculated sighting to commence the month of Ramadan and also Shawwal. And throughout the lunar calendar, inshallah, we'll be adopting this. And I just want to give reference, I know I'm taking a couple of more minutes to conclude here, is that we are in a certain circumstance, and the jurists, they talk about something called the urf, the custom, something that is permissible in a different part of the world, it may not be permissible here, something that is permissible here, it may not be permissible in a different part of the world. I just said I was in Saudi Arabia for Umrah. There's not a single masjid in Saudi Arabia or any Muslim country where they allow two Jummas to take place in the same masjid. It's not allowed in any Muslim country. But you ask any imam, any faqih, any mufti here, they'll say, yes, you can do Jummah. I was told that in downtown, there's one masjid that is operated by MAC where they have four Jummas. And the reasoning is because we're not in a Muslim country. There in Saudi Arabia on Jummah, it's your holiday. So everybody has the ability to go to a Jummah. Another thing is in this space here, it's very limited. We struggle to find space. So we have the option, either these people don't perform Jummah or we do another Jummah so that we can accommodate the rest of the community and people with different schedules, right? In different parts of the Muslim world, the Mufti will tell you it's impermissible to do interfaith work. It's impermissible to do interfaith work because we're going to get people confused. You talk to ulama and scholars and muftis here, they say you need to do interfaith in this part of the world. Why? We need to build ties. We need to share the message of Islam. We need to respect one another. Different parts of the world, in the Muslim world, they'll say it's haram to say Merry Christmas. Why? Because it gives a suggestion that you're talking about God being born. Na'udhu billah, Jesus is not God. But the muftis and the scholars in this part of the world, they say, make sure your intention is clear. It's you're in a non-Muslim world where everybody is celebrating Christmas, or you're just saying Merry Christmas not to believe that Jesus is God or Son of God. It's simply to share the sentiments. So things can vary based on location and circumstance, and this is what we call deeper fiqh. This is what we call jurisprudence. And the one who is aware, Sheikh Abdullah Kapodrawi, rahimahullah, great scholar who lived here for many years, I would often go sit in his company to learn from him. And he said, you know what, the more a person gets and dives into the knowledge of Islam and the sciences of Islam, the more broader their mind and their heart becomes about the teachings of Islam. The less a person knows, they'll argue about the smallest things where there is so much flexibility in the deen of Islam. So we need to understand that there are, in the moonsighting issue, every method is permissible. No doubt the sunnah method, the actual practice of physically sighting the moon in your own city is the precise sunnah. But it does not necessarily mean all the other methods, calculation, local sighting, global sighting, international sighting, are not allowed. They are all allowed. And regardless of which opinion we follow, we need to respect one another. Even if another masjid, another organization is adopting another methodology, we need to respect one another. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu and Abdullah ibn Abbas, they differed in more than 100 masail, 100 rulings. They had difference of opinion. I disagree with you. But they, whenever they would talk about one another, they would praise one another. That sahabi is an amazing sahabi. He is a person of knowledge. He is a person of dedication. So they differed in their opinions, but they never differed in their hearts. Imam Hanifa, you study any of his books, any of the Hanafi fiqh books, you will find Imam Hanifa is giving an opinion, and then you have Sahibain on the other side. Sahibain refers to Muhammad al-Shaybani and Abu Yusuf, rahimahullah, who are his dear students. They would differ. They were teacher and students, but they would differ in different matters because that was their understanding and interpretation of the Quran. And the teacher allowed this difference of opinion. He didn't say, how dare you have a different opinion than mine? I'm your teacher. They had difference of opinion because it was based within the framework of Islam. So I applaud the efforts of the directors here at the Islamic Foundation of Toronto. The reality of the matter is even these moonsighting committees, they use calculations. If anyone reports to them that they've seen the moon, they first look at the moon maps. Is it possible to be seen? And then if it's possible, they will accept it. If it's not possible, according to the moon maps by Khalid Shaukat or Ilyas, who's astronomers, Muslim astronomers, if they have not determined that it's possible, then they will not accept it. And vice versa, if someone is rejecting it, they'll say that, look, it was possible to be seen according to the calculation. So even the moonsighting committees, who claim to say we only look at the moon, they actually use calculations, they actually use hisab. So the reality of the matter is we are advancing. The Prophet ﷺ, he never sat in a vehicle, the vehicle that we sit in. You know, one of my teachers, and I'll conclude with this, I can say so much, but I'll conclude with this. One of my teachers, he said, some of these people, they say, you have to like the Zahiriyya, you have to literally follow the precise action of the Prophet ﷺ. So he said, if anybody asks you this, you tell them, how many times did the Prophet ﷺ eat meals? He only ate once in a day. The Prophet ﷺ only ate once in a day. How many times do we eat? We have breakfast, we have snack, we have tea time, we have lunch, we have tea time again, we have Timmy's time, and then we have dinner, and then we have dessert, and then after Tarawih programs, there's all kinds. So we really want to follow the sunnah, eat once a day. The Prophet ﷺ didn't restrict the religion. He expanded religion. There's no doubt. There are usul, and there are principles, and there are fundamentals. We have to stay within those fundamentals, and the experts of the religion, they'll tell us. If someone tells us there's more than one God, we're going to say, no matter what happens, there's only one Allah. But where there's flexibility, we allow the flexibility. So once again, the announcements will be made by the Islamic Foundation of Toronto that we are adopting the hisab, we are adopting the calculations to determine the lunar months, And inshallah, we will know the dates in advance for Ramadan, for Eid, etc., for years to come. And again, this is not to swerve away from the Sunnah. It's actually in two principles of Islam. One is taysir, to make matters easy. We can get, you know, hall bookings, we can get time off from work, so on and so forth. And the other is maslaha. There is a need for this change. And many of the Islamic organizations in North America have already adopted this years ago. The Fiqh Council of North America, ISNA, ICNA, MAC, many masajid, the IIT here, they have all already adopted this methodology, so it's nothing new. It's just we're getting on board as well, and more Islamic organizations will be adopting this as well. So we make dua that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to understand the true spirit of our deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us steadfast on the teachings of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to welcome the month of Ramadan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to value every moment in the month. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakallah, Mufti Yusuf, for educating us and enlightening us on this very important topic, doing this for the unification of the community and the unity within the community, inshallah. Allah bless him and bless all of us. At this time, I'd like to request the volunteers that have been assigned for line collection to please proceed now. And I'd also like to request if there are gaps or spaces ahead of you, please move forward and fill those gaps. I can see brothers are standing sort of in the hallway trying to get in. So please move forward, fill the gaps, inshallah. Last Friday, the line collection here was $4,517. Jazakumullah khair, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward all of you for your generosity and your contributions. IFT is hosting a workshop on the introduction to coding for kids aged 8 to 11, in partnership with DeanWord. The workshop will be on February 24th from 10 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. Spots are limited, so please sign up your children as soon as possible. You can visit our website for further information. Learn self-defense is happening this Sunday after a Dhuhr Salah in the gym. The cost is free, but the registration is still required. Sisters are also welcome. This is the second self-defense session, and more will be added after the month of Ramadan, inshallah. We encourage the community to come out and learn this important skill. And again, more information can be obtained on our website. We also have the ongoing free income tax clinic. This free income tax clinic filing service is provided to low-income families, including seniors, students, newcomers to Canada, and the Indigenous Canadians for over 14 years. This service will be provided, has been running since March 1st, will be running from March 1st and will run till April 30th, inshallah. And again, the information can be handled on our website. Islamic Foundation has sent the 2023 tax donation receipts, both electronically and by email as well as postal mail. So please check, and if you haven't received it, please let us know. Approach our office or send us an email. We're also excited to present the Welcome Ramadan program for our community, which will be hosted by our very own Mufti Yusuf Badat next Sunday, March 3rd. That will be at 6 p.m. after Salatul Maghrib in the gym. Admission is free. You can come in person or you can watch it being streamed live online. Dinner will also be served. And the Islamic Foundation of Toronto is pleased to announce the 17th annual Hifz Qiraat al-Quran Adhan Nasheed competition. Online registrations are now open. New categories for this year, such as the Adhan and Nasheed, have been added. We've also added a Qiraat category for brothers and sisters who are 25 years or older. Registration deadline is April 29th. And for more information, you can go to qiraatcompetition.com. And finally, Madina Masjid is having their 10th annual spiritual retreat program this weekend, Friday, February 23rd to Sunday, February 25th. Registration for the workshop and basketball tournament can be done through their website at madinamasjid.ca. At this time, I'd request everybody to please switch off their cell phones for full concentration during the prayers. Jazakumullah khair and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله